is anointed. The preaching, the teaching is anointed. Even our fellowship is anointed. In Jesus' name we pray. We want to tap into this corporate anointing. In Jesus' name we pray. Let everyone say amen. Again, this morning I want to teach on the anointing because of what God is doing in our church. I got to teach on principles of the Holy Spirit so we can embrace Him, receive Him as He moves throughout our church. So this morning, the anointing. It is the anointing that makes the difference. There are three things in this teaching lesson I want to do. Three things I want to what? All right, number one, the definition of the anointing. Everybody say that with me. What is the anointing? I hear people talk about the anointing. I hear it on TBN all the time, books being written about the anointing. What is the anointing? I pray for the anointing. I am pursuing the anointing. I am passionate. I have a passion for more anointing. But what is the anointing? Turn your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 10. Isaiah chapter 10. I love this. Isaiah chapter 10, and it gives us, if you will, a definition of the anointing. Isaiah chapter 10, look at verse 27. Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27. Everybody there? And it shall come to pass in that day that his burden shall be taken away from off thy shoulder, his yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke shall be what? Because of what? I love it. The yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. So in defining the anointing is the yoke destroying, burden removing, manifested power of God. I love it. There it is on the screen. The anointing is, let's read it together. Come on, class. The yoke destroying, burden removing, manifested power of God. I love it. The anointing has everything to do with the ministry and the function of the Holy Spirit. But again, the anointing is the yoke destroying, burden removing, manifested power of God. Let's keep working. Turn your Bibles to Exodus chapter 40. Exodus chapter 40. I just want you to see this principle here. Exodus chapter 40. In Exodus, early on, God told Moses to take off your shoes from off the feet because the place wherein you stand is holy ground, symbolizing, dealing with the anointing. Exodus 40, and look at verse 9. Everybody say, teach, Pastor. Exodus 40, look at verse 9. And thou shalt take the anointing oil and anoint the tabernacle and all that is therein, and shall hallow it, and all the vessels thereof, and it shall be what? Holy. This is talking about the place. Watch this now, because the anointing deals with the ministry of the Holy Spirit, but it also deals with the presence of the Holy Spirit. Once again, the anointing deals with the ministry and the function of the Holy Spirit, but it also deals with the presence of the Holy Spirit. But more than this, watch this now. The anointing deals with more than just the place. It deals with the person in the place. Somebody help me here. And that's the atmosphere that we want to create and cultivate within our worship. Glory to God. The anointing is what enables us to accomplish and fulfill God's will in our lives. That's why, again, I say it is the anointing that makes the difference. Everybody say the anointing. There are various levels of the anointing that is clearly seen in the life of David and pictured in Ezekiel. There are various levels of the anointing. David was anointed three times. And with each anointing, there came a degree of responsibility. David was anointed in 1 Samuel 16:13 when he was called. His calling was confirmed by Samuel. He was anointed the second time in 2 Samuel chapter 2 when he was anointed king over Judah. He was anointed the third time in 2 Samuel 5 when he was anointed king of Israel. And with each of these three different anointings, the responsibilities increase. Listen to me. The anointing can be measured, but here's what I want you to see. Just as in the life of David, we can grow in the anointing. Lift up those hands and say, God, take us to another level of anointing. To further define, not only in the life of David, but also pictured in Ezekiel. Ezekiel 47 talks about the different degrees or levels of anointing. Ankle deep, knee deep, waist deep, and then they were completely immersed. Again, describing the different levels of anointing. To further define the anointing, there are some symbols of the Spirit that depicts the ministry and the function of the Spirit, but also talks about the different aspects of the anointing of the Spirit. The wind, the breath of God, the fire, the purging of the Spirit, the dove, the personality of the Spirit, water, the cleansing of the Spirit, wine, the control of the Spirit, the oil, the power of the Spirit. From a pastoral perspective, I love the symbol of the oil. Oil symbolizes being smeared, being covered, being immersed in the power of the Spirit. Let's flesh it out for a minute. Turn to 1 Samuel 16. 1 Samuel 16. This deals with David's first level of anointing. 1 Samuel 16, when his calling was confirmed by Samuel. 1 Samuel 16, look at verse 13. Everybody say, teach PT. 1 Samuel 16, look at verse 13. The oil of the Spirit. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. When God does something, everybody gonna know about it. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. I love it. I love it. David was anointed with oil. I want to be, that's my passion. I want to be an anointed pastor, preacher, teacher. Oh, anointed. I pray for more anointing. Everybody shout the anointing. Let's keep working. Psalm 92. Psalm 92. Psalm 92. Look at verse 10. Psalms 92, verse 10. This is what God is doing in our church through the anointing. But my horn shall exalt like the horn of a unicorn. Watch this. I shall be anointed with what? Come on, class. Say it again. With what? Everybody shout again, fresh oil. That's what God wants to give us, fresh oil. Not some stale religion, not some boring tradition, but he wants to give us fresh oil. How many of you know that being in his presence, not only is it fresh oil, but it's refreshing? Somebody shout glory. Let's keep working. Turn to Psalm 133. Psalm 133. Again, this is the culture that we want to create within our church. Not just occasional, but perpetual. The anointing. This deals with, Psalm 133, deals with a kind of corporate anointing that we want to tap into, that we want to flow with. Everybody shout, get in the flow. Uh-huh. This is what God wants to do with us. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in what? Unity. He's unifying us. Verse 2, it is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down the beard, even Aaron's beard, and went to the skirts of his garment. That's why I'm, as the head, I'm teaching on it so the body can receive it. Verse 3, here it is. As the dew of Hermon, watch these word pictures. As the dew of Hermon and as the dew, here it is, that descended upon the mountains of Zion. I love it. You can clearly see a picture of the anointing, a picture of the Spirit descending upon the church. Zion in Scripture is a picture of the church. The Holy Spirit just hovering over the church. Somebody say amen. Watch this. This corporate anointing, here it is right here, that we want to tap into, that we want to flow with. Watch this. For there, everybody say right here, 3703 North Memorial Parkway. For here, right here, the Lord did what? Commanded the blessing. And even life, everybody shout life, forevermore. Glory to God. That's the kind of experience we want to tap into, that we want to flow, not just occasionally, but perpetually. This corporate anointing. Our worship is anointed. Our praise is anointed. The preaching and teaching is anointed. The fellowship is anointed. That's why I say it's the anointing that makes the difference. Somebody shout the anointing. Glory to God. So number one, we see the definition of the anointing. Number two, I'm not going to hit this point long, but number two, the desperation of the anointing. Everybody say that with me. Now that we have a pretty good working definition or working knowledge of the anointing, we should desire the anointing. Glory to God. Now that we know what it is, we should desire it. That's why I come up with the desperation of the anointing. Watch this, because when there is learning, there should be some yearning. That's why I'm teaching on principles of the Holy Spirit, because now that we have a better working knowledge of his work and ministry, we can desire him that much more. Because watch this. Where there is expectation, there is manifestation. Come on, talk to me. Oh, Lord, that's what we want to create within this place, an appetite, a desire for more anointing. The Bible says, as the deer pants after the water brook, so pant I after your word, oh God. Desiring him, like that article, pursuing him. So church, let's continue to seek him. Let's continue to expect him. Let's continue to crave him. Come on, talk to me. Because when praises go up, God shows up. Can I get a witness? The Bible says he inhabits the praises of his people. I'm talking about an atmosphere of the anointing. Everybody shout the anointing. Glory to God. So number one, the definition. Everybody say the definition. Number two, the desperation. Everybody say, I want more of the anointing. Here it is right here. Number three, the demonstration of the anointing. We got the definition, which causes a desperation. And watch this, which results in a demonstration. Did you get the flow? We got the definition, which causes desperation, which results in a demonstration. Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 3. Everybody say, teach, PT. Matthew chapter 3. Look at verse 16. Matthew chapter 3 and verse 16. And Jesus, everybody shout Jesus. When he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him. How many of you want to live under open heavens? Somebody say amen. And he saw the Spirit of God. Here's one of the symbols of the Spirit, descending like a dove. The Holy Spirit is not a dove, but he descended as a dove and lighting upon him. Glory to God. Now notice the phrase upon him. The Holy Spirit was upon Jesus. I can say it like this, not just upon him, but up on him. Glory to God. Here's the principle I want you to see. Jesus did not do any ministry without the anointing. Therefore, we too should not attempt to do any ministry without the anointing of the Spirit. By way of hermeneutical observation, there were no recorded miracles of Jesus prior to Matthew chapter 3. After he was anointed, then we see the miracles occurring, which signifies the necessity of the anointing of the Spirit. Glory to God. Turn to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Luke chapter 4. Look at verse 16. Luke chapter 4, verse 16. Everybody there? And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. You can clearly see from verse 16 that Jesus loved the church, as indicated by the phrase, as his custom was. Going to church was a holy habit, if you will, for Jesus. He loved coming to church, and that's what we want to do. That's the culture, the climate we want to create, that you love coming to church, because not because of a great experience, but because you experience God. Jesus loved church because he knew at church he would meet God. Come on, talk to me here now. I know it's Valentine's. You know, a lot of people come to church to meet them a mate, but I hope you came to church to meet God. Can I get a witness here? Look at verse 17. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. When Jesus went to church, the first thing he got was his Bible, which lets me know that the Bible, the Word of God, should be central in our worship. Everything centers around the Word. He got the book of Isaiah and began to read. Watch what he says. And when he had opened the book, that's what I'm doing, opening up the book. Underline that phrase in your Bible. Open the book. He found the place where it was written. On this particular day, Jesus went into the church. He begins to read Isaiah 61, which was a prophecy concerning himself. Here's the principle I want you to see. As Jesus was reading the word, he saw himself in the scriptures. He was reading from Isaiah 61 and said, "That's me." That's what I want you to see. Every time you read the word, you got to see yourself in the scriptures. Help me, Holy Ghost. By Jesus' stripes, if you're sick, when you read that word, you got to see yourself healed. I am more than a conqueror. You got to see yourself being more than a conqueror. See yourself in the scriptures. Everybody say, teach, pastor. Look at verse 18 and 19. Luke chapter 4, 18 and 19. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance. Everybody shout deliverance. Deliverance. Where there, in the anointing, there is deliverance. Somebody say deliverance. Deliverance. Deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind. Here it is. And to set at liberty. There it is again. We don't just want Jesus to be a visitor. We want him to be a liberator. To them that are bruised, verse 19, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. So even Jesus equates the Holy Spirit with the anointing when he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me. He equated the Holy Spirit with the anointing. The anointing is the enablement, the endowment, the empowerment. And Jesus had a threefold anointing, if you will. He was anointed to preach, teach, and heal. Jesus was anointed preaching, teaching, and healing. Look at verse 20, 21. And he closed the book, gave it again to the minister, and sat down. And the eyes of all of them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. Verse 21. And he began to say to them, listen at this, this day is the what fulfilled? The scriptures. Jesus was the fulfillment of this scripture. Jesus was and is the anointed Christ. Here's what I want you to see. This scripture is fulfilled in your ears. Watch this. The word, make sure you get this now. The word is anointed to do what it says. Oh, yeah. The word is anointed to do what it says. That's why reading the Bible is different than reading a Jet magazine or reading any other type of book, because the word is anointed. Glory to God. The word is anointed. There is anointing in the word to heal. There is anointing in the word to deliver. There is anointing in the word to save. Listen to me. We already know that Jesus was anointed. Watch this. The word is anointed. The word is as anointed as Jesus is. Because Jesus is anointed, his word is anointed. Everybody say, I want the anointing. Let's keep working. Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. Look at verse 38. Acts chapter 10, verse 38. How God, I still hear pages, anointed pages. Are y'all liking this? Amen. Amen. I love it. I love it. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth. So who anointed Jesus? God did. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. Watch this. Who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Oh, Lord. Notice again that it was God who anointed Jesus. I know you got your degree, but do you have the anointing? I know you got a gift, a talent, or a skill, but do you have the anointing? It's the anointing that makes the difference. Somebody shout glory. There is an ecclesiastical problem, and that is there are people in the church trying to do ministry without the anointing. Singing in the choir without the anointing. Teaching without the anointing. Trying to be a leader without the anointing. Witnessing without the anointing. Preaching without the anointing. I'm reminded of the story in 1 Samuel 17 when David tried to wear Saul's armor. No, listen, it's the anointing that makes the difference. Listen, it's not my hoop that makes the difference. That's just my celebration. It's the anointing that makes the difference. Can I get a witness here? I mean, I can hoop you all day, but if ain't no anointing in it, it just sounds good. But it's the anointing where there is deliverance. Glory to God. Let's keep working. 2 Corinthians 1. 2 Corinthians 1. And look at verse 21. 2 Corinthians 1. Look at verse 21. Glory to God. We just started at verse 20. It's good preaching. Verse 20 it is anyway. For all the promises of God in him are yeah, and in him amen, unto the glory of God by yeah. Somebody ought to say amen right there. Somebody need to hear that. Here it is right here, verse 21. Now, he which establishes us with you in Christ, underline that, in Christ, and hath done what? And hath anointed us is God. God is the one who anoints us. Watch this. Who have sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. Pay close attention again to who it is that anoints us. It is God. Verse 22 is really dealing with the salvation experience. Watch this. If you are saved, not only does God fill you and seal you, but he also anoints you. Listen, God has anointed you to do whatever you do. You got to know that. God has anointed you to do whatever you do. Somebody say amen. The level of anointing you have determines your productivity. The anointing is the outflow of the Spirit through the human vessel. You are anointed with a purpose. Somebody said it like this. You don't need the anointing if you're not doing anything. Turn your Bible to 1 John. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. Everybody shout the anointing. Glory to God. 1 John chapter 2. Look at verse 20. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 20. But you have an unction from the Holy One. Oh, Lord. This unction is the Holy Spirit. It's the anointing. It gives me the unction to function. I function because I have this unction. The anointing. Everybody say the anointing. Look down at verse 27. But the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you. One more time. Everybody say, I'm anointed. That's what I want you to see. You are anointed. This verse deals with fact versus faith. It is a fact that you are anointed. It says it right there. We are anointed. But here, fact, we are anointed. But by faith, are you walking in your anointing? Glory to God. What are the keys? I'm closing. What are the keys to manifesting this anointing? A, integrity, power, and warfare. In Exodus chapter 28, the Bible says of the devil, he's called the anointed cherub. Make no mistake about it, the devil was an anointed minister of music. He was anointed, but he perverted his anointing. Watch this. You may be a math teacher and be in sin and still teach math effectively. But you can't be in ministry and be in sin and expect to minister effectively. Help me, Holy Ghost. Listen, listen. Integrity, power, and warfare. Yes, you are anointed, but you only walk in that anointing as you walk in the holiness of God. So A, integrity. B, inquiry, prayer, and the word. The key to maintaining and manifesting the anointing is prayer and the word. Prayer and the word gives birth to the anointing. You can't have the anointing outside of prayer. You can't have the anointing outside of the word. Come on, talk to me. More prayer, more anointing. More word, more anointing. Prayer and the word gives birth to the anointing. See, here it is right here. Intimacy, praise and worship. We want, according to this article we read, this is the goal. If perpetual hunger for God is the goal, and it is, perpetual hunger, that we experience the habitation of his spirit, not just occasionally, but perpetually. Here's the key right here, not just integrity, not just inquiry, but here it is right here, intimacy. Everybody shout intimacy. Oh, Lord, that's the key to maintaining this culture and climate that we want to create within our worship. Intimacy, one more time, everybody say intimacy. Intimacy with God comes by spending time with God. Intimacy comes by knowing God. And the only way to know God is to know the God of the Word. Intimacy comes by trusting God. Intimacy comes by knowing God. I'm repeating. It comes by spending time with God. It comes by trusting God. Watch this now. Intimacy comes by praising God. So if you don't mind, let's just stand on our feet right now. Let's just stand on our feet right now and express our relationship to God. Because that's all intimacy is. It's just us having a relationship with God in worship. Go ahead, church. Praise him for blessing you. Praise him for forgiving you. Praise.